All team, give it everything you got.
It's time to fangirl flail with Fangirls Going Rogue.
Count me in.
I don't think there's anything more important in the Star Wars universe than the fans.
News, discussion, and commentary from the female point of view.
You call this a diplomatic solution?
No, I call it aggressive negotiations.
With your hosts, Teresa Delgado, Tricia Barr, and Sarah Woloski.
Boy, am I glad to hear your voice.
Strap in, because this is where the fun begins.
I like the sound of that.
Welcome, Yub Cubs, to Fangirls Going Rogue. I am one of your hosts, Teresa Delgado, and with me, as always, are my fangirl best friends. First up is Tricia Barr from Fangirl Blog, currently coming to us from Walt Disney World. Report in, Tricia. How is the Disney?
The Disney is fantastic. I'm vaccinated and I'm ready.
Have you done anything yet, or have you just been at Disney Springs, or what?
Disney Springs, and I ate a margarita cupcake.
I was about to say you ate a margarita.
from Sprinkles. It is this seasonal cupcake.
Have you been to Gideon's yet?
Dude, the line was so long. Nope.
Was it really? Oh, mm-hmm. Man.
Yeah. And that was like there's like a virtual queue, and then you get in the line, and the line was so long. I'm like, nope, I'll wait.
Ugh, man. I mean, I don't know if I really want to eat Gideon's. I'm not sure I could even eat like half of one of those things just because they look huge and they look really rich.
What is it?
Gideon's.
It's like a cookies.
Yeah, it's like a gourmet cookie place.
Okay. Wow.
It's and new. People get in a virtual queue at the beginning of the day and they might not get in until the afternoon.
Wow.
Yeah, it's like the hot thing down there right now.
Goodness.
Mm-hmm. And Sarah Woloski from Skywalking Through Neverland. I have a bone to pick with you, ma'am.
Why?
I have a bone to pick with you. How do you not like Logan? Like, Rory should have been with Logan. Dean is ridiculous.
Dean was so cute. She's his first love.
No.
I love it.
No.
Oh. Is this a Gilmore Girls thing?
Yes. Yes, it is. But Logan was such an asshole. I'm sorry, I have
stopped,
to say
but
it.
But he stopped being that way. He grew up a lot.
You know what? First impressions mean a lot to me, and that's just how it is.
Look, I would meet halfway and say just after he grew up.
I can see
in
that.
Season six.
I can see that. But at first, he was kind of a little bitchy too.
He was worse.
Yes.
He was worse than Logan.
Yes.
Dudes, I have to bring this up. It's not in the show notes, but you guys are talking about Mighty Ducks Game Changers. And I watched it. I watched the first episode and I love it. I have to keep going, but thank you. Yeah. I wouldn't have watched it except for you guys.
Isn't it
Mighty
amazing?
Ducks Game Changers is literally life changing. It's a game changer, if you will.
I love it that it comes out the same day as the Falcon and Winter Soldier, because you watch Falcon and Winter Soldier, it's like heavy, right? And then you're
right,
like,
and then
all
you
right.
decompress with
yes.
game changers.
Yeah, it's yes. perfect.
Well, and the reason, if people haven't watched it, it opens with the podcasters doing their wraparound.
Yes.
And I was like, oh my God, this kid is precious. He's like doing the wraparound for the podcast. And he's like, dude, and I'm like, this kid is like so spot on podcaster. I'm like, holy crap. I'm like, this is like so good. So whoever wrote it was a podcaster for sure.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And of course,
I mean, I think
that came to mind because Gilmore Girls, we have the same actress.
Lauren Graham.
Yeah. Lauren Graham yep. is on both. And she's amazing. Like, she's my favorite character on both.
Well, the interesting thing is that Lauren Graham plays the mother in a lot of different shows, and she always plays like a character that's very similar. And that is really similar to her. Like personality too, which is nice. But yeah, I really like Mighty Ducks Game Changers so far. So we'll see where that goes. But I like it.
Yay.
Oh my gosh. Okay, so we're gonna start off the show today talking about Falcon, Captain America, and the Winter Soldier.
I like how you did that. That was good.
Now we're
I I loved how it changed at the end, how they changed it out from the Falcon to Captain America. And I was like, that's right.
And I think we should say now that, yeah, spoilers, everyone.
Spoilers, by the way. Yes. Okay, so I want to say this first. All right, Falcon and the Winter Soldier. This is the second Marvel TV show to air on Disney Plus. The first one was WandaVision. And this one had me from like the first 5 minutes of the first episode. Whereas WandaVision, I never got all the way there. I was like kind of standing in the kiddie area of the pool. But like this one, I was like diving straight into the deep end, swan dive style. It was great.
Well, let's give a little summary just for the heck of it, in case you're listening to this a long time from when you've seen Falcon and the Winter Soldier. So this series follows the story of Bucky Barnes and Sam Wilson after they've returned from the snap. And Bucky Barnes is the Winter Soldier and Sam Wilson is the Falcon. And Steve Rogers has bequeathed the Captain America shield to Sam, and Sam must decide if he wants to take up that Captain America mantle. And Bucky is now a civilian and must atone for all the damage that he did as the Winter Soldier. It was in a series of 6 episodes that aired on Disney Plus between March 19th and April 23rd of 2021.
And it was super good.
Okay, so that's interesting. I find it great that we have a different level of likes on this, because I guess, so that's your overall opinion of the series, Teresa. You just were like totally in, right?
Totally in.
Trisha, what about you?
Totally in.
Oh, wow. Okay. Okay, nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I think because we're definitely going to span this, because I know, Sarah, you loved WandaVision and maybe not so much hot on this one, right?
Yeah. I mean, I liked it. I liked where it took us. I just feel like a little bit of it was a little clunky, and they could have used like an episode or two more to really flesh out the character story. So I did appreciate, like Sam's story I thought was fantastic in this. Bucky's not so much. So, and we'll get into that a little more, but I felt they did a really good job with Sam.
I think Bucky's story was kind of a little rushed, and there was things that weren't as explained as maybe they should have been. But I also kind of felt like that wasn't really necessary. I mean, we've had so much of Bucky with, you know, the Winter Soldier movie and all that stuff. And honestly, like, I like the Winter Soldier now, but like Captain America and the Winter Soldier is like the worst Captain America movie to me. Like, I just don't like it. So I was kind of fine with it. Plus, I cared more about seeing a lead that was a person of color and investing in their story anyway. And so that was more important to me than anything. So I appreciated that. And I appreciated all of the very real to this world stuff that was talked about and featured in this show. And I am so glad that they went there, because I feel like they easily could have just towed the line and they didn't. Now, did they go as all in as maybe I would have liked for them to? No, but they did more than they've done in the past. So I'm appreciative of that aspect of it.
Yeah, I feel similar to that. I feel like it was really good that they commented on everything happening. And all, actually, they did pull back a little bit, because the whole Flag Smashers storyline, they were supposed to be dealing with like a pandemic and a virus and a vaccine. And so they like pulled that out of the story, which is why we didn't get those Flag Smashers storyline really fleshed out as much as we could have. But yeah, I think this was a story that needed to be told, and we all needed to hear it.
I mean, my favorite quote from the whole show is still, "You're Black Falcon." And he was like, "So does that mean you're Black kid?" Like, not only that, but like, I talked to some of my students about it around the same time that it was airing. We had track and field season going on, and the majority of my runners are Black. And so we would talk about the show because they were watching it, and they loved it. They loved, you know, just how prominently featured they were. They loved just all aspects of it. From looking at them and seeing it through their eyes, like, that's something that I think really matters, is that my teenagers that are going out into the world and are going to start doing things that they saw themselves, they appreciated it and they respected it and they liked it. And I think that was important. So we kind of talked about how much we liked it in comparison to WandaVision, but like, as far as your excitement before the show actually started, you know, when we, like with WandaVision, I wasn't excited at all. With Falcon and the Winter Soldier, I was mediocrely excited, and then they got me. Versus Loki, from the latest trailer we've had of Loki, I'm actually really excited about Loki because I feel like it's going to be weird, and also Lightning McQueen is in it, so like, I'm good with that.
Ka-chow.
As priorities. But now I'm scared they're going to let me down because I'm actually kind of excited about a show. So I feel like I should just like really lower my expectations and then like maybe it'll be fine. Tricia, are you not excited for Loki at all?
No, I love Loki. I love Tom Hiddleston. Like, just go on YouTube and search Tom Hiddleston dancing for 6 minutes. Because, you know, I'm like totally into those YouTube deep dives, like Tom Holland spoiling Spider-Man for 6 minutes. Google that. Have fun.
Or
like,
Tom Holland speaking in an American accent instead of a British accent.
Tom Hiddleston, I love him anyway. Owen Wilson, Lightning McQueen, right? So for people who didn't get that reference, and I feel like they're just going to do weird. So we're going to get weird. And this is about the multiple versions of the Loki. We're going to have Lady Loki, Kid Loki, Tom Hiddleston playing himself against himself, Loki. So we're going to, it's an exploration of identity. Like, how many versions of yourself can you be? So Loki's going to be like a really cool, weird version of that. And it's going to, you know, it's about time and different multiverses and all that. So I'm like, okay, let's get weird. I'm for it. Like, I love when Star Trek does like crazy stuff like that. Like, we went through time, or,
oh yeah,
when
had the whole Kelvin, you know, timeline. Like, I was down with that.
Yeah. Like, just do something different. Like, go totally weird. Mm-hmm. So I'm into that. I was so excited for WandaVision, and I think it exceeded my expectations. At the end, I was a little more excited for what I thought they could do. And I've talked to a couple women who are, you know, that I talked to about feminism and stuff like that. And I thought they could have gone a little bit more for Falcon and the Winter Soldier. I knew it was going to be more MCU. I knew the director was a little bit more of like serious storytelling stuff. And I think visually, like what she did as a visual storyteller is stunning. If you really stop and look at it, if you go back and watch it again and you just stop and look at like scenes, like, Bucky standing on the pavers that are different color pavers for Moya, and they're at a crossroads for their characters. Like, stuff like that is so good in this show. And you expect that in a movie. You don't necessarily get that in a TV show, because it's TV's faster. They don't have the time, and they spent all that same energy on it.
Well, they had, I mean, some great shots and very hugely memorable shots with the shield itself,
yeah,
in mm-hmm. this show. I mean, the image of the shield with the blood on it from that low angle was like, oh my, like that's the image that sticks in my mind when I think of
and
the series.
Sam trying to wipe it off.
Yes.
Yes.
Just,
I mean, there was so much. It's kind of like what we've said about The Mandalorian, I think, which is, yes, it's TV, but they're approaching it as if it's movie. As if it's film. And I think, for me personally, I think Disney Plus has given all of the Disney properties, and including National Geographic and everything, this amazing opportunity to create things that weren't possible before. And I think they're doing it in a much different and better way than all the other streaming services that are even making their original content. Because I feel like the way that they're creating shows is just so much better than like what Hulu is doing or what Netflix is doing in a lot of cases. You know, maybe not with everything, but I guess it helps to have money and be like the biggest company out there that's making stuff. But I don't know. It's very exciting.
Well, the fact that they tapped the composer for Falcon and, or mm-hmm. they have the same composer for Falcon and the Winter Soldier that also composed the music for Winter Soldier, the movie, and as well as Civil War. And so he has originated these themes for Falcon, for Bucky, for the Winter Soldier. And yeah, he used that, and got to actually flesh out Sam's theme into this whole big bluesy Louisiana rock number that, you know, you hear at the end credits as well. As well as when he's coming in, flying in, and saving the day.
Sarah, you said it a minute ago that your favorite moment or most impactful moment is like the shield being used as a weapon and that image of it with the blood on it.
Yeah.
And I agree that that was very impactful. I would say for me, I kind of have two favorite moments from this. The first one is something that just sticks out, which is Falcon flying in very slow, carrying Carly's body and placing her down on a stretcher. Like, that was just like, I just loved everything about that, just because of the respect that he has for her, even though she was doing something, you know, that he didn't agree with. So there was that. And then the second one for me is the beginning of the very, like, just the very, very beginning of the show, where he's flying in and out and all over the place. And I was like, it was so cool.
It was a really awesome action scene. They like spent half the budget on that scene.
Right.
That's why they used it in like the trailer and everything else. Like, don't worry, we're going to do some MCU stuff in this.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, going back to that moment of John Walker using the shield as a weapon. I mean, you know, that shield is very, it's symbolic. And Steve Rogers has carried it for 80 years. I mean, he was in ice some of the time, but yeah, he's, you know, and he's given such meaning to that shield. And the fact, and a shield itself is a defensive like object in itself. So the fact that he uses that, John Walker uses that to like behead a man. I think that's what happened, right? Did he behead that guy? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I had a visceral reaction. I was sitting and like my hands were over my face. I was like, I almost screamed at that point. I was like, I can't look, what is happening? Anyway. And I just like that moment just really got to me. And I actually texted Bryn McKinnon, because she has kids who watch it with her. And I'm like, you know, Bryn, you may want to watch this episode before you watch it with your kids, because I don't know, like, I don't have kids, but I don't know. I just felt like that was like a level above whatever we have seen in the MCU films itself.
I don't know, though. I mean, I feel like it's hard to explain. I mean, I'm not a parent, but I am around kids a lot. We don't give kids enough credit for the stuff that they watch on their own when their parents aren't around, and the things that they're exposed to at school and all that kind of stuff. And like a lot of kids, by the time they're like 8 or 9 or 10 years old, they've already seen things and know things about the world that we don't think that they should. I just think back to when I was like that age, and my mom tried to be protective of things that I watched, but I know I had already seen blood and guts and like all kinds of stuff by the time I was like that. So
Thor whacks Thanos' head off
in
the movie. So in John Walker's point of view, he thinks that's the bad guy. So as far as Marvel doing something that graphic, it's just, it's an inversion of the idea of you're doing it to defeat the ultimate baddie because the person he did it to didn't kill his friend. It's right. That guy is it's not an innocent bystander.
Right.
In the equation of it, but he isn't the person who did the killing. So it's complicated because we've seen both sides of the story, as opposed to Thanos snap people, no big deal, cutting his head off. If that's except other than there's no way out of it once you cut Thanos's head off, which is kind of the quandary they get themselves into in that movie, because you're like, well, what are they going to do with this movie? And then they, you know, Thor gets a little cranky. So
in The Mandalorian, people get cut in half by doors.
Oh, that's true. You know,
in Star Wars, Darth Maul gets cut in half. We see Jabba the Hutt grossly strangled by Princess Leia. So
I think to me it was just the symbolicness of it. It was just very the level of the meaning of it, I think, was what really got to me. I think that's what it is.
It's a something that's supposed to be for good doing something bad. I think it's supposed to disturb you.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think it worked. It worked. It's like if you didn't hate Umbridge, then there was something wrong, you know? Mm.
Right.
Absolutely. Harry Potter reference. Trisha's like, okay.
What?
Well, Trisha didn't share her favorite moment.
Trisha, your favorite moment or your most impactful moment?
Okay. I have two. And I appreciate that both WandaVision and Falcon and Winter Soldier have created everyday cosplay stuff that a person who doesn't want to work too hard at it can do. So like you could wear the Wanda sweats on having a bad day, and the most you'd have to do is get a red wig if you didn't want to go through the dyeing the hair. And most cosplayers would appreciate if you just did it with your own hair, because they would get the sweatpants and my life sucks and I don't know how to get out of this. But I appreciated Val because she's a little bit older than me. She's got a purple streak in her hair. That's very doable. Hoop earrings, a really cool overcoat and high heel boots. And I could do that at a con. That's not too hard. So I am going to say that I really appreciate what they did for people who want to be part of the club and not work too hard at it. And then as far as like impactful moments, even though I loved everything that happened with Sam, I feel like my favorite, this is so stupid, my favorite moment in this whole show is when Bucky is holding his arm up and the kids are hanging from it. which is second to the scene when Sam is doing his training montage and his nephews chase him. And then, you know, and earlier Bucky's there and they're pointing at the shield, just like kind of admiring it. So I just love that the shield is something that these young Black boys are looking up to, something they can aspire to with their uncle. And they even call him Uncle Sam and they chase him. But that's so cute. And Bucky shows up with a cake and the kids are hanging from his arm. And it was something that used to assassinate people with, and he's not wearing the gloves. Mm-hmm. And it was just, I was like, oh, I'm just taking a breath and smiling at what happened, that it's going to be okay for Bucky too.
It's the opposite of the shield being used for bad. Now the arm's being used for good. Well, as a monkey and there bars.
There was another moment involving the arm that I loved, which is when the what are they called? The
fingers.
Wakanda Forever.
Dora Milaje.
When those people, when she just like is in the middle of fighting and detaches his arm.
Oh yes.
And he's like,
"You have this power, but I can take it from you, and don't you forget where it came from."
That was awesome, because I just love when Sam was like, "Did you know it could do that?" And he was like, "Nope." No. That was fantastic. So good. And that whole fight scene with them and them making an appearance, I loved everything about that. I love all things Black Panther. There's something about everything related to Black Panther that I am just completely obsessed with.
But give us the Wakanda show. I know it's coming, but I want it sooner rather than later.
100%. And actually, I'm going to call out one of my coworkers who doesn't listen to this, but I'm going to do it anyway. He walked into my office today, and he's a Black guy. He coaches our softball team, and he's also assistant football coach. He walked in wearing a Black Panther mask today and dressed like Black Panther. And I was looking at him and he just walked in and he was like, "Wakanda forever." And I was like, "What are you doing?" And he goes, "It's National Superhero Day. Why don't you know this?" And I was like, "What?" And I fell out of my chair laughing. I was laughing so hard because it was not something I expected to happen today.
That's amazing. Anyway.
It's not very often coworkers of mine show their nerd side. So when they do, it usually catches me very off guard.
I have to say, you guys, because you know I'm not a dark side girl. I'm not. But I love Zemo.
Yes. Mm. I have to share that. Love.
He's a very interesting character. Well, speaking of that, Tricia, why don't you talk a little bit about that? Like a character that you related to or that stood out to you the most?
Well, Zemo stood out, so I'll talk about him. He's utterly bad. But there's something just, you understand why he's bad. And you understand he's clearly the character who's wrong. But he has all the right reasons in his rationalization that there shouldn't be super soldiers, people with superpowers. He says that Steve's an exception to the rule that people could have superpowers and do the right thing. But he doesn't have all the information. He doesn't know about Isaiah Bradley's character. He seems to be disregarding that Bucky's trying to do the right thing and recover. Hmm. So Bucky is in the process or journey of proving Zemo wrong. And Zemo, he wants Bucky to fail at his journey. He doesn't want him to succeed in denying that programming. He wants him to fail so that it'll reinforce his belief that people who have the super soldier serum will be bad people. Bucky does get that moment where Zemo is standing in front of that monument. Bucky walks up. Zemo's accepted that he may die, but he wants to pass on this information to Bucky. You need to stop all the other super soldiers. And Bucky doesn't shoot him. He's doing the lessons that he was given in the first episode of rule number one, rule number two, rule number three. So do no harm. I think that's rule number two.
Yeah, it's rule number two.
Zemo's scared enough. We already saw that in the episode before when Bucky almost, threw the teacup or whatever. And as he was, he kind of has that sigh of relief where he's like, "You didn't kill me that time." Zemo always knows he's skirting the line. Daniel Brühl is like amazing. He was also Lightning McQueen, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he played was the voice.
Teresa has a has a shocked look. You didn't know that? Look at her.
I know.
What? She's like.
So the German version. He did the German version voiceover for Lightning McQueen. Well, I want to add to that, Tricia. Zemo was the one I really liked to watch, and especially his interactions with Sam and Bucky. But I do appreciate Zemo on another level in that he is a very smart character. And so he has his reasons for doing things, but he thinks about how he's going to manipulate people and how, he knows the psychology of people and how to get to them. Like, for example, the kids in this compound of the flag smashers, I guess, Sam and Bucky are walking around, Carly, where are you? Dora, whatever, they're just like, come on, guys. And Zemo quietly goes to the kids with his Turkish delights and like, "Hey, you want some candy, kids? All right, give me some info." He knows. And I just thought that was very smart. And then also I love how, I think it was the Dora Milaje fight, right? In his apartment. And he's just quietly standing, waiting for people to, fight. And he's not going to engage unless someone engages with him. And then he uses the opportunities that are presented to get ahead. And so he like disappeared in that fight because, so I thought that was great. I like that as a character trait as well.
I would say for me, the character that stood out the most is Isaiah Bradley. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is, I don't know, I kind of feel like that is just a really true thing that happened a lot, is that, people of color were overlooked or were abused or used and were never given credit for the things that they did. And everything about that story of Isaiah Bradley is representing a whole bunch of people of color, a whole bunch. And I like that they brought that out. I like that they brought that to the forefront and they acknowledged all of that. And they showed real pain and real hurt and real, like, what that looks like, especially for someone that was fighting for their country because they viewed it as their country, and then they were betrayed by their country. I mean, that is something that is currently happening right now in our society and has been happening since, you know, the birth of America. I mean, it has never gone away. It has never changed. And that is sort of the sad reality of the, you know, of what we're living in. I think about stories that my grandparents told me and that my grandpa told me, you know, during like the Jim Crow laws times and things like that, because my grandparents were born in the 30s, you know, so it's like, it's just really interesting. And I'm glad that they did that. And I'm also really glad that they sort of showed the progression with Isaiah Bradley and the Falcon as they started to understand each other. And when they get to this point to where Sam finally understands, I can't say Isaiah Bradley is alive because of all of these things, and it would cause him more pain and more hurt. But I can make sure people know who he was and what he stood for, along with all these other people. And that was an amazing thing to see at the end of the show. So like that whole storyline and everything, but the Isaiah Bradley character really stood out to me. And then also his grandson or great grandson or whatever, he was funny too. Because he's doing everything he can to protect his grandparents and all this stuff. And then all of a sudden he turns, he's like, where are we going? What are we doing? How are we, you know, when he's finally like, okay, my grandpa's accepted you, so you're cool now.
Right. Well, yeah, I felt Isaiah Bradley was really a good storyline too. And I mean, the actor was just fantastic as well. And also Sam kind of had some choices to make, you know, is he going to take up this Captain America shield? And he had an example in front of him of John Walker, who didn't do so well with the shield. And then Isaiah Bradley is on his other shoulder saying, oh, but a black man can't carry the shield. And so Sam just has to like really stick to his guns and say, well, what do I represent? What, you know, like, am I strong enough to take on this shield, this mantle? And so I think that was a really, really powerful opportunity there.
Well, I think something that Isaiah Bradley said, which is that no self-respecting black man would be Captain America, I think that was a really good line, because there's a lot to unpack from that statement. And I think that Sam's character really thought about that and about what that means, mm-hmm. and about how, you know, how he could be who he is and be proud of who he is and his culture and all of that, and still represent the America that he believes still exists deep down in the heart.
Yeah. And Sam and Sarah, his sister, counters that point. And no two people's experience is the same. And I think there's a really powerful message in that Sam's experience is not the same as Isaiah Bradley's. And you can completely understand and respect Isaiah Bradley's perspective and make a different choice. And that's kind of where, you know, all of us need to be as people, to understand not everybody's going to have the same experience and not everybody's going to make the same choice. The same choices aren't going to be the right for different people. And the story did a good job of saying there's not everybody can be Sam, but they made a point of making Sam the optimistic person who's always trying to work with people and sees he hasn't been beaten down enough that he sees that there isn't a way forward trying to make America better. In his viewpoint, you know, and carry that shield. That's his perspective. And they play that out through the end of the episode, where instead of fighting, he doesn't fight Carly. She keeps telling him, fight me, he won't. And then he uses everything that's happened so far to try to share, I think his superpower is empathy.
Yes.
And he's trying to share his empathy with the, you know, you senators and GRC, that's right, right?
Yeah, the GRC, correct.
Yeah, that you guys have all had this experience of being powerless. And that's what Carly's experience has been all along. She doesn't have power, so she sought power. And so you guys have a shared experience. Understand why she did what she did, why she chose the moment. And that's so everything plays out. He doesn't fight in the end. Well, and I like, too, that he's willing. He says to the one guy, oh, you've earned your ass whooping. So at some point, Captain America needs to whoop some ass, right?
Yep.
But his superpower ultimately in the end is empathy and trying to share. Not, he doesn't keep the empathy for himself. He wants to expand it to everybody else.
Yeah. Yeah, I love that. Oh my gosh. Okay, so was there anything that you didn't like or you thought could have been better? And I don't know. I think, Sarah, you and I probably have a very similar one. pretty much everything to do with Sharon.
Oh.
Not into it. Not into it. Just not into it.
Well, she could have been. I was very excited for her in this series, like to see her. And she got her one moment of ass-kicking scene, right? But then, you know, and it was pretty clear that she was going to be the power broker. I mean, who else could it have been? But my one moment that I think could have been done better is, so when I get offered a job at the US government in a high level position, you know, I maybe wait a little bit longer than halfway down the steps of the government office to call my nefarious underling about infiltrating the US government. I don't know. What do you guys think?
I just have issues with the whole thing. I mean, I liked seeing her.
Yes.
And I love the actress that plays her. But I am so tired of seeing the actress that play her always play this character that's playing two sides of the coin. And I'm like, look, this isn't revenge. Okay. You do not have to be your character from Revenge. It's okay.
Love that show, by the way.
I loved that show. Oh my God. Although that's a whole discussion for another time. But I just want her to be a good guy. Is that so wrong to want her to just be a good guy? Like, what the
heck? It's definitely a turn because I really liked her being a good person. But here's the thing. I completely had figured out why watching Captain America, the first Avenger, watching Peggy Carter and seeing how as a storyteller they were framing it that this character has just, Peggy Carter is definitely an extreme for the good, and you could easily flip that type of mentality for the bad. And Sharon got abandoned. We know that. They make a point of reminding of that. We know she got screwed. She wasn't a superhero. And she got screwed because she didn't have power. And so she's trying to reclaim power and she's trying to rise up because she got abandoned in this, you know, when the snap happened, she definitely was abandoned. And so she's trying to get that back. She's trying to find a way. And I think it's a powerful statement. Even as a woman, you know, you leave these women to, they have no way, you know, no way to climb up. There's no resources. What do you do? Maybe sometimes you end up being a Val or a Sharon because that's the only way into the circle. That's the only way to survive because they're going to leave you out. So I understand as a storyteller exactly where they're going. And I put this in the show notes. So I might as well bring it up now. I think we have a little bit of a Luke Skywalker problem here where The Last Jedi did this leap with Luke Skywalker where they took Luke Skywalker to this point in his story. And some people couldn't get into it because they didn't understand how Luke Skywalker got to that point. And so then you see Luke Skywalker, cranky dude, drinking green milk, grumpy. He isn't what you thought he would be. He's something else. And they give you enough information as a storyteller that you as a storyteller can understand the leap. I could totally work out the Sharon Carter perspective, but a lot of people spend a lot of time on the internet after Last Jedi trying to explain that to people. And so when you're looking at it as a storyteller, it's you understand it, but not everybody has that logic. And so I think Sharon's staying kind of symptomatic of that. Storytellers working out the logic, but they didn't give the people enough for them to get there. And then you end up where it with a disconnect where people are like, that didn't work for me. And I can totally understand that. I said she was a power broker from the beginning. I understood it completely, but I feel like I'm not the normal viewer. I'm a different type of viewer because I do storytelling.
You're the super story viewer.
Yes. So I completely understand. Like when I watch Last Jedi, I'm like, well, I understand what they're doing. I don't like it. I didn't not understand what they were doing. I could just say, I don't like it. And I could say, I don't like what they're doing with Sharon. I would have preferred her to be a good guy, but I understand exactly where they came from. And I think a lot of people's reactions are this, you didn't give me enough information. If you had told me, I want to see, for me as a Luke Skywalker fan, I'm okay with Luke Skywalker going to where he goes, but I want to see how he got there. And as a Sharon fan, I can totally understand how people would say, I understand why she's there, but I want to see why she's there.
Makes sense. That makes sense. Definitely. All right. So that brings us to like this finale. Were we satisfied with where the series went, like where it ended up in the final episode? And why or why not? This sounds like a term paper.
Yes.
So, Teresa, were you satisfied?
I was satisfied. Very much so. I was fine with it. Other than the Sharon thing, I'm fine with it. I'm ready for Captain America 4.
Yeah, exactly. For me, the best episode was episode 5. And I think that I feel like when we did the Fangirls Going Rogue Facebook discussions, that was the one that had the strongest positive reactions as far as it moved people. It did a lot of things. It's, you know, got action in the beginning and then it's just people talking. And it's kind of crazy that you could want that. That I think episode 6 did exactly what the storytellers wanted. I think it gave us what we wanted. I personally don't think Carly's dead. Oh. And yeah, she's not. It's established in the earlier episodes that she got shot and she was back in fighting form. John Walker broke his arm. He's back in fighting form. She's the only super soldier that's not with all the others that are blown up. She's taken away and everybody wants that super serum soldier. So she's not dead. That's my opinion. And it's funny because people are like, oh my God, they killed Carly. I'm like, nah, they didn't kill Carly. Come on. It's a Marvel movie. They killed Fury. Not really. Come on. She's not
going to only kill a super soldier by cutting off its head. Like a zombie.
There's just so many clues in the story itself that, that she wouldn't be dead as far as this super serum, the version that John Walker took. Because even in the Facebook discussion, one person brought up that night, well, you know, there's nothing that Steve Rogers doesn't have healing powers. I'm like, but John Walker and Carly both got major injuries and were both back in the fight almost immediately. And I said, there is precedence in this TV show for there being healing powers in the super serum soldier.
Wow. That would be amazing. I would love that. I was satisfied with Sam's journey. Bucky's not as much, but I feel like there was one moment that was missing from this series that I really wanted to see. And it was Sam making the deciding like moment of putting on the Captain America suit and his wings and his taking up the shield, because you cut from season 5 where Sam opens up the case and it just cuts, right? You don't see really his response to it on his face. You don't see that. And then the next time you see Sam, it's as Captain America flying in the window with the awesome music behind him, you know, and he is Captain America. I feel like we needed the moment where you see like his jaw set and he decides, like that decision is on his face. Like in WandaVision, you get that moment where, you know, Wanda is literally changing into the Scarlet Witch and taking her power. So, and also similarly, like in A New Hope, you see Luke Skywalker, you know, when he sees his homestead burning, you know, the camera turns on his face, the music swells, and you see his jaw set. It's like he has become the boy has become a man and he's decided to go on his journey. So I feel like we were gypped. We didn't get that Sam moment.
I feel like we did though, but it was when he decided to start training with the shield. That moment really exists in that episode, in episode 5. The fact that he even started training with the shield, he has a moment where he looks at the shield and then you start going into like the whole like training montage. So like for me, that is that moment, you know.
Oh, I'll have to watch again.
Because he has to decide, like if he's going to train with the shield, that's a decision in and of itself. Like at that point, you know, when he goes to put on the outfit, he's already made the decision. You know, you're not going to do all that training and all that stuff without already having decided. So for me, it was in that.
Nice. That's okay.
In episode 5.
You make a good point. I should watch that again then.
Yeah. But I mean, I would not be opposed to just seeing him standing there, you know, putting on the Captain America outfit. Like, that's what we're talking about. I'm not opposed to that. I will say, though, that I really wanted to see the outfit. And then when he just opens the case and then it cuts out, I was like, oh, come on. Mm-hmm. Come on. But then someone showed me, or I guess I saw it online, too. They showed the all of the pictures from the comics of what it was going to look like and stuff like that. And I was like, oh, okay. That's what
it's gonna I'm be. Glad they kept the wings.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cause
Torres is supposed to be the Falcon. I mean, from the comics, from what I've heard, the next Falcon is that Torres character. So
that was my one pick. I love Torres and I would love more. I understood where they cut him, but please put him in everything else.
Yes.
I want and he's in the Top Gun movie, you guys.
Oh, that's right.
And his helmet is Fanboy. I just think that's so cute.
Bucky and Sam's sister, please be in a relationship because that was awesome.
Sarah and Bucky.
I think after episode 5, Jonah said something like there were already 13 fanfics for Sarah and Bucky on the internet. So I was like, woohoo, go people.
That's hilarious. I'm gonna
read all your fanfics.
Oh my gosh. All right. Well, I have one final question for you guys. Do you want another season of this or do you feel like it's not necessary?
I don't think it's necessary. Just give us the movie.
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same place. Like, I actually sort of like this whole idea of we're not just creating shows to create shows that have season after season. Mm-hmm. You know, the fact that these shows have a purpose, almost like how Rebels had a purpose. Yeah. It was to go from point A to point B and then it's done. You know, I actually kind of like that because then it's not just this never ending sort of thing. And then they just recycle storylines, you know, i.e. Grey's Anatomy, which I still watch, but still I like this whole like one and done sort of thing. All right, we're done with this. We got to tell the story in this format. It gave us more time to do that. Now we can have Captain America 4.
Exactly.
I agree too. I love that.
Well, there won't be another Falcon and the Winter Soldier anyway, because it would be Captain America and the Winter Soldier.
Or the White Wolf.
It was interesting because they changed his name. They changed it at the end of Captain America and the Winter Soldier because I feel like he's not taking White Wolf.
Yeah. No.
At this point, even though they brought it up a bunch of times. It was like people kept calling him White Wolf and he didn't take it. And then in the end, they flipped it and Sam took the mantle of Captain America that he didn't want. Mm-hmm. I'm good with if Disney says this story, I want to put on the big screen and do it in a 2-hour movie. That's that. And this one, we want to give it a little more meat and play with some more characters. And it's only one and done. I'm good with that too. And if they want to mix it up or if they want to do something as a trilogy, I mean, there's a potential that Captain America 4 is really the middle episode on the film of a trilogy. For Sam Wilson's Captain America type thing. You know, this was the origin story. They gave it a little more time. We almost got what not 6 hours, but 4 hours.
Yeah.
4.5 hours of it. And then we might get a movie that's bigger, and maybe they go and do a longer story on TV again. I mean, give it sort of a trilogy vibe, but not quite the same.
All right. So moving on from that, there has been some Marvel stuff that has popped up. We've gotten some trailers. We mentioned the Loki trailer a little bit ago, but we've also gotten the Shang-Chi trailer as well. I mean, I'm excited about Loki. I'll admit, I'm not as into any of the movies that are coming up in this like second wave of movies. I'm still going to watch them. I'm just not. They all seem like sort of off characters, you know? I mean, we've already done all the heavy hitters. We've gotten all of them other than Black Widow, which is coming eventually. But yeah, all these other ones, I'm like, I don't know who you are. It's sort of the same as it was for me when Guardians of the Galaxy came out. I was like, what the huh?
Yeah. Well, I feel you, but Guardians of the Galaxy ended up becoming one of my top two MCU films, so I'm going to give all of these a chance, because I just feel like...
Oh, yes.
Yeah. I feel like they have potential to be my favorite, so even though I know nothing about them, so yeah.
I just want to go to a movie theater.
I want to go to a movie theater, but this next trailer that we got, we're not going to get to go to a movie theater, I guess, because it's going to be on Disney Plus. It says streaming on Disney Plus. It doesn't say anything about being in the theaters, which is the new Pixar film, Luca. I wasn't excited about it until I saw this trailer that just came out.
All right. So what made you excited about it?
I know it's a Little Mermaid in Italy.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. I guess I just didn't realize, like, for me, I originally was like, okay, two kids in Italy. Cool. I didn't realize that it was going to be sea monsters that come out of the water and like can actually just be human looking. And then if they get splashed with water, they look like sea monsters, you know?
Mm-hmm. It was like totally Little Mermaid vibes though. Like the opening.
Oh, yeah.
Even the town kind of looked vaguely like that town.
You can't go out of the water. It's a big scary world.
Yes.
Okay, Ariel, little boy, here we go. Uh-huh.
Yeah, so this should be interesting. I think it'll be cute. The Disney film I'm most looking forward to is the one that's going to be all about magic and is in, like, Colombia.
Yeah, what is that one called? That's what I thought Luca was, but then I saw it.
I don't remember the name of it.
Oh, okay.
I don't remember the name of it. I mean, I think it's still in production anyway. It's not coming out this year.
That's Lin-Manuel Miranda's.
Yes, it's Lin-Manuel Miranda's film, yeah.
But he's doing all the Disney films, so that doesn't compute.
Yeah, right? It seems like it. But yeah, he has Into the Heights coming out.
Oh, well. God.
Yes.
Yes, please. Also, this isn't in our show notes, but the new trailer for Steven Spielberg's West Side Story.
Don't tell me. I need to see it. Oh. I haven't seen it yet.
So excited.
It's like very nostalgic to the original movie. I was surprised.
Okay. Is Rita Moreno going to be in it?
She's in it. She's in the trailer.
Yes.
Whoa.
Oh, my God. Okay. Well, this just got a whole lot better. All right. Well, speaking of, Rita Moreno was a presenter at the Oscars this year. There was some really interesting stuff that happened at the Oscars. I know not everybody is big award show people. I am. However, I'll admit that I didn't even know when the Oscars were.
Yeah. It's so out of sync.
Mm-hmm.
I will say that they did a weird order, which I thought was odd. They did Best Picture before they did Best Actor and Best Actress, which is really weird.
What about Best Director?
And that was done at the very beginning.
Yep.
Whoa.
Uh-huh. And there was two very cool Disney things that happened. Disney won Best Animated Feature, which I was like, okay, which Disney film is it going to be? Is it going to be Onward or is it going to be Soul? You know, I know people wanted Wolfwalkers to win. I know, Tricia, you were rooting for Wolfwalkers. I am always, because I am a shill, wanting Disney to win. So I didn't really care which Disney movie won it. It just didn't matter to me. But I am glad that Soul won it. I'm glad that a movie that had a person of color as the main character won. That's cool. Also, they won Best Score.
Oh, yes.
Which is awesome because I love John Batiste and his speech was fantastic.
Man, you know, what's deep is that God gave us 12 notes. It's the same 12 notes Duke Ellington had, Bach had. It's the same 12, Nina Simone, and all the nominees. I just want to first point out that every gift is special. Every contribution with music that comes from the divine into the instruments, into the film is special.
He's just like freaking out like a little kid, like, this is so cool, you know? And so I love that. And then, of course, Chloe, I don't know how to say her last name.
Zhao.
She's directing The Eternals. She's the first person of color to win Best Director, and she is the second woman ever in like 90 something years to win Best Director.
Wow.
Look at 90 something years. And she's totally like that. She's like not makeup. She doesn't dress up.
She wore sneakers.
Yeah. You guys, I think we're going to get blown away by The Eternals. I was blown away by what she did with The Rider. It's like, I watched that movie and I was like, okay, she's doing things like visually storytelling wise. And it's not a story. It's not a movie for everybody, but if you just look at the talent and the storytelling where she had no money and she just made this movie, if you can imagine if someone gave her all the money and all the tools in the world and the best actors in the world, we don't even know what we're going to get with Marvel. Marvel is legitimately going to contend for a best picture, I think, next year.
I think it better.
A Marvel movie.
That'll be a first, because tentpole movies,
I know, they don't and get yet, such amazing storytelling. Like,
Oscars are the lowest rated this year, and part of that is because so much of it is about giving, you know, movies that people have no idea what they are. And, you know, some of the biggest movies, our most favorite movies, used to win Oscars.
Yeah, in the 90s, I was totally Oscars all the way, all the time. It was amazing. Yeah.
I feel like they went this route of, we need to be the artsy awards, mm-hmm. and that the Golden Globes are the awards that, you know, are the more pop culture-y awards. And I don't think that's fair, you know. Do I think that Star Wars should win everything that they're nominated for? No. Do I think that Disney and Marvel movies should win everything that they get nominated for? No. But I mean, at least like give them a chance to. I mean, before there was a best animated feature category, you know, Beauty and the Beast mm-hmm. won best film.
Yep.
So, you know, I understand why they separated that category and I get it, but I'm just saying that I think the Oscars needs to lighten up a tad and quit being pretentious.
Like Glenn Close shaking her booty.
Oh my God. That was the best thing ever. The best thing ever. One of the best things that they did at the entire Oscars was this song trivia where they walked around and asked different actors whether the song had been nominated, won, or wasn't either of those. And they played different songs and they went to Glenn Close with the song called Da Butt from the 90s, right? Yeah. And she knew it. And then she did the dance where she basically twerked on TV.
God bless her.
It was awesome.
Okay. You guys, Oscars were on ABC, right?
Yes.
So I'm going to segue into ABC Good Morning America.
Oh, yeah.
So, calling all Star Wars fans, are you excited about where the Star Wars universe will take us next? Tweet us a video with your question and at Dave Filoni might answer it live on GMA.
No date attached.
No date attached. We're guessing, right? May the 4th.
Well, May the 4th is a Monday. isn't
Tuesday.
It?
It's Tuesday.
It's a Tuesday. Tuesday.
Yeah.
Sure. Why not? Absolutely. Sure. It's going to be. Yeah.
What would you ask Dave? I laughed because the first person I saw
was Jonah Marie.
It was Jonah Marie. Yes. And I hope they use your question. But what would you ask your question about where the Star Wars universe will take us to Dave Filoni if you could ask him?
I would ask, so Dave, how many lunches have you had with Kevin Feige?
I would say, when are we getting the Star Wars Marvel crossover film? When is that coming?
Oh, wow. That would be really cool.
Well, or when is Moana going to show up in Star Wars?
Poor Dave's like, I just got Star Wars. That's all I got. That's all I got. You know, they had announced that Kenobi would start filming in April, and we are now at the end of April.
Yes.
So I'm going to presume that we will get a little hint from the set of Kenobi when they talk to Dave Filoni. And that's all I got.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so.
So my question is, will Ewan McGregor cross the screen and go, hello there, and walk away?
Kenobi! Oh, okay. Okay, I know. Will Darth Maul be in the Kenobi movie?
There you go.
But I'm excited for Kenobi. I'm excited for anything Star Wars at this point, because I feel like we're in the dark times.
We are in the dark times, but apparently Dave Filoni is going to talk about the future of Star Wars, so I'm interested.
Definitely. Me too. And also, something going on right now that kind of is the future of Star Wars is the High Republic. Mm-hmm. That's basically been what's been keeping me into Star Wars right now, and I've read all of it so far. I need to work on the comics, but I did want to say one thing about the High Republic, which is, if you haven't read the comics, you need to read the comics. They flesh out the story of the High Republic so much, and the artwork has been really good. But there were three call-outs. I just wanted to call out the YA book, the middle grade book, and the adult novel that are coming out. The next adult novel, which is continuing Kevin Scott's story from Light of the Jedi, which is going to be Rising Storm,
nice,
is coming soon. And then Daniel Jose Older, which is one of my favorite Star Wars authors right now, has the middle grade book called Race to Crash Point Tower, which I'm very excited about. And then Justina Ireland, she had the middle grade novel of the first wave, and she has the young adult novel this time called Out of the Shadows. And I'm pumped for that because one of my favorite characters is Vernestra Rowe, and she's getting to continue her story. And I'm excited about it.
I'm excited to have another wave of books because I devoured the first wave in January. But I also, so Light of the Jedi, I read because we got the preview book, and then I also listened to it. So the musical Jedi, Avar Chris, like, she's the one, you know, I love. And, but she has an English accent in the audio novel, and that bugged me. I was like, why do all the women in Star Wars have to have this English accent except for Leia? And like, cause when I read it before I listened to it in my head, you know, I just heard a normal, you know, my voice or something, you know, cause she's me. So to hear the English accent, it just bugged me. And the way she would say certain things on the thing. It was like, oh.
Well, you know, and we talk about this a lot on Star Wars Bookworms because of the fact that we review the audio.
Oh.
Well, we review the audiobooks as well. That's mm-hmm. part of what we do, if you didn't know, on Star Wars Bookworms. Yes. We review the book and the audiobook. It really depends on who the narrator is. And I will say this, if you haven't been listening to the audiobooks, the more recent ones, especially for the High Republic, the audiobook for Into the Dark, which is Claudia Gray's YA novel in this wave, new narrator, fantastic. So fantastic. It was so great. I love Mark Davis, and I have Mark Thompson and Jonathan Davis. Let me just mush them into one person. I love both of them, but having a break from them and from the main Janeray Lavoie, who's one of the main girl narrators that they've been using, was so fantastic. It was so good. So I would recommend Into the Dark, which is the Claudia Gray novel, but as the audiobook. I thought it was really good. My next audiobook I'm listening to would be the next Thrawn book. And
oh, that's good. I listened to it.
We'll see.
Okay. Well, we won't get into that discussion now because I know how you feel about those.
No. I like Thrawn. I'm just saying we'll see when it comes to the audiobook because there are things.
Okay.
Go back and check Star Wars Bookworms for all of our Thrawn reviews and you'll totally get it. Also, if you haven't listened to Star Wars Bookworms, I'm going to take this moment to plug us really quickly. There is a lot of me teasing the crap out of my co-host, Aaron, because he mispronounces words a lot. So if you want to hear that, go listen to Star Wars Bookworms.
Is that one of those things where you read words and you decide they're a certain way and then that's what you're stuck with? Or is it just regular words?
No, it's all mispronouncing Star Wars words. So that's what makes it even funnier because most Star Wars words you can say like three different ways. So that's why it makes it complete nonsense.
I always love when you're in a panel and an author says something and you're like, oh, that's never how I pronounced it.
Right.
In my head, when I read your book.
Yeah. All right. Well, the biggest thing that's going on is May the 4th is coming up. But like as we record this, it is only a few days away and the Bad Batch will be coming out on May the 4th. So we just want to let you guys know that we will have a very special episode for you. So we're not going to talk about the Bad Batch now, but it is coming on May the 4th, as if you guys didn't already know from every social media platform that Star Wars touches. There's a Hunter Bad Batch poster out there for you.
And it's Tuesday, May the 4th, a longer episode, and then Friday, back to normal schedule, a regular length episodes. Just for people who are wondering, there'll be two episodes next the week of May the 4th.
And the longer episode is really like a movie. I mean, it's movie length.
Yeah, I was shocked. I was like, when's this going to end? It's like animated, and it kept going. And I had to click the thing and go, oh, I got a ways to go here.
So block some time out.
I didn't look at the link. Yep. I was not expecting that. I thought, oh, well, it's getting late. I can handle 30 minutes. Oh, it's not 30 minutes. Okay.
If you guys are confused about, I don't know if you guys said this because I was throwing my cat out of the room. We all were given screeners. So that's how we're saying this right now, by the way.
That's just very so y'all true. Know.
It's nice. Thank you, Disney.
You're welcome. Just kidding.
Shout it out to the social media from Teresa and Tricia and Sarah. Shout it out, fangirl shout outs.
You guys should probably do the shout outs, or Tricia should, because
I
wasn't ever there except for once for like 2 minutes.
Yeah, I couldn't.
Teresa, who showed up for 5 minutes to say she loved it and then had to go back to work. She was hiding away in her work. So I got to admire your commitment to that. But thank you to everyone who came to the Falcon and Winter Soldier Zoom calls. You know who you are. And I'm not going to do everybody's name because I know I'll miss somebody again and I'll be beating myself for a week about it. We will be returning with Saturday evening discussions on the Bad Batch and Loki. They're 8 p.m. Eastern time, 7 p.m. Central, 5 p.m. Pacific time. And nobody has to come to all of them. If you want to pop in for one, if you want to pop in for 15 minutes and just share your reactions, if you want to pop in and just listen, we have tons of people who do that. We have Sue who listens a lot, and then Sandra calls her out at the end and makes her talk. But Sue opened up as we went along. So everybody, you know, you do your comfort level, but if you just want to pop on and listen to people talk, you're more than welcome.
Yeah. And I just want to mention, like, the only reason I haven't been going to them is because I'm usually working at the Lego store, which I was this past Saturday, but I was on my break and I happened to see the announcement about the discussion as I was scrolling through Facebook on my break, and I checked the time and it was the right time. But just know if you pop in for 5 minutes, you might have to follow Sandra having a very deep, meaningful discussion about things And then you follow it up with, hi, I'm here for 5 minutes. I thought it was really great. Okay, bye. And feel really bad about it.
No, it was good. It's fun to hear people share their love.
It was just I just want to say, Sandra, if you are listening to this, which I hope you are, I thought what you said was amazing, and I really would have liked to have commented on it and had a discussion about it, but I literally had like 2 minutes.
I go take care of the customers.
Yeah, I know. Buy all the Lego.
Yeah, same for me. I think I was able to come for like 15 minutes one time, but Saturdays have now become busy for me as the pandemic kind of ends, which is
that's a good thing. That's a good thing.
That's a good thing.
It's good and bad because I liked staying home. So
I agree with you. I agree with you. I'm right there with you.
So I can't often make 5 p.m. on Saturdays, but when I can, I love to show up and say my piece. So thank you for bearing with me when I had a call and I had to Zoom out of there.
Like Sarah's usually like ironing or sewing or doing something in her office. I'm like, she's multitasking. I'm so impressed.
Mm-hmm. Or cooking dinner. Yes.
That's true. Yeah. You cook dinner. I think Bryn cooked dinner one time too on it. That was fun.
Look at all these women cooking dinner. What is that like?
I don't know. My mom said, did you cook dinner? And I said, 1-800 takeout, mom. Yeah.
My mom knows better than to ask me if I cook dinner. That's like not a thing.
Okay. I will shoo Richard out of the kitchen. This is my space.
We have to have a serious discussion now.
Yeah, we do.
I want to know, it's collecting corner time. I want to know why Marie from the Aristocats is making a comeback. Please, Teresa, explain it to me.
Yo no sé, bro. That's the amount of Spanish that I know. means I don't know. Well, first, before we go there, I do have a serious thing I need to say. I don't know why my friends don't know that I'm a collector. I didn't know that people didn't know that.
Oh, because you did the
plastic chats.
Yeah, I didn't know Sandra didn't know I was a collector. I really thought she was kidding. She didn't know. Hi, my name's Teresa. I'm a collector. I have a problem.
You implemented the collecting corner in our show.
I know. Okay, so as far as Marie, I really don't know. And what's funny about that, you bring that up, is I was watching some YouTube channels for Disney World stuff, and they were going through what's new at Disney. And there was all this Marie stuff.
It's all over the place.
There's Marie stuff everywhere. And I just want to say, why just Marie? What is wrong with Berlioz? And what is wrong with Toulouse?
God. Toulouse is like the coolest.
Toulouse is the best out of all of them. I don't understand. But with Marie, there was a makeup collection that came out from a brand called I Heart Revolution. The second I saw it, I sent it to Tricia, who promptly freaked out just as much as I did. And I know you got some of it. I got all of it. I bought the whole thing. I showed it to Greg and he goes, when does it come out? And I told him, and he was like, all right, get it all. And I was like, yes, sir, Captain. And I got it all, and I have the little paw brush, and it is the cutest little thing I've ever seen in my life.
It's in the shape of a cat paw, and the packaging is the cutest thing. It's like all the names on the packages are like so Marie.
Yeah,
see,
they're so cute. And the paw brush fits perfectly on my cheek to apply my blush and my bronzer because I have a good sized face for it. But yes, there is a Marie makeup collection by I Heart Revolution. You can go to revolutionbeauty.com or go to Ulta. It has sold out a couple times. So just keep an eye for it. It should come back. And then our friend Amy Ratcliffe just came out with her fifth book.
Wow.
Which is The Art of Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, which I am going to get if I don't get it in PR, which I might. I don't know. I never really know until they show up. But The Art of Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, it looks good. It looks like all the other amazing art of books. So I'm excited for that. And then let's see. Oh, there's been some new Loungefly that has launched that is amazing. Yeah, some awesome new Loungefly. We're going to talk about the Ahsoka Clone Trooper Loungefly's debacle in a minute.
What?
Ahsoka ears all over again. We will we will discuss. But first, there's a cute, cute Raya and the Last Dragon lounge, tuk-tuk Loungefly. It's actually not a Loungefly. It's not a Loungefly backpack. It's a different brand, but it looks like a Loungefly backpack, and it's really cute. And then, I don't know if you guys knew this, but this year is actually Winnie the Pooh's 95th anniversary of the first book. And there's been a lot of stuff that has come out. I got some stuff from Box Lunch that was exclusive to Box Lunch. There is a Funko Pop of Winnie the Pooh dressed as a bee. And I believe like a week before I bought that, I told you guys I did not need any more Funko Pops. Mm-hmm. And then I bought this one. And then I also bought the Loungefly backpack that is the same. It's a Funko Pop version of Winnie the Pooh as a bee. And he has little puffball antenna that are soft. And then I didn't know until I got it, he has wings. They're clear, which is why I couldn't see him in the picture. Aww. But it actually has wings. And it is adorable. And those are on Box Lunch. So you can actually go over there and get those now. But we'll talk about this other stuff, and then we will talk about the Ahsoka Loungefly.
We don't want you guys to forget your mamas who are for fangirls on Star Wars. So StarWars.com does have ideas. But you know what? Just if your mama likes geek stuff or Star Wars stuff, don't forget her. Make sure you get it in time. Make sure you get your card. So this is your friendly reminder for none of us who are moms but love our mommies to take care of them.
Or if you have a mom like me who is not a fangirl of anything except Hallmark movies, then go to the Hallmark channel and get her some Hallmark wine.
Ooh, that's a good idea. Nice. So, you guys, did you check out the Her Universe Star Wars collection? Anything popping for you guys?
I did check it out, and I'm going to... okay, we're honest here. We are always honest here. Nothing stuck out. And I think the reason is I feel like I hate to say this, I really do, but I feel like there has become a lot of lack of originality when it comes to Her Universe merchandise. And I said this at the beginning when Her Universe was bought out by Hot Topic, that I was afraid this day would come where everything was going to be designed as if it was to be put in a Hot Topic store. And I think we are getting there. We're getting to that point to where it feels less like Her Universe and less like our universe and more like made for Hot Topic with a Her Universe label. I also don't really like the fact that HerUniverse.com is 85 to 90% Hot Topic merchandise and a very small percentage of actually Her Universe product. You have to be really careful when you're buying off the site, because if it doesn't say Her Universe or our universe in front of it, it is a Hot Topic product. So that's just something to think about. I like the design that she has for all the Tano stuff, but I feel like because I have the long sleeve that we got at Celebration, I have the zip up jacket and the snappy pants.
Oh, wow.
And I have the kind of boxy t-shirt that said Tano across the chest.
That you don't need more.
And I just don't really need more because I feel like I would just be recycling the same pattern over and over. So that's why I didn't get anything. I do like the design. I like the modern sort of feel about it. And I like that. I can't really wear crop tops because COVID gave me a stomach. I can't really wear the little tie front shirts, you know, again, because COVID gave me a stomach and that I need to lose. And also we're not wearing bike shorts right now.
that was an interesting choice.
You know what's funny about that? The bike shorts are the ones I like the most. I'm like, I might
get
that.
Which is great. But you've been doing some working out.
I have really nice legs, so yeah.
I mean, here's the thing. I have good legs. However, I finally am getting that body that you get in your mid-30s where you have like a butt and stretch marks and a stomach and stuff. And I think about working out, and then I think about how hard working out is, and then I think about how easy it is to sit on the couch, and then I let my depression take me, and then I just play video games.
Understood.
So, needless to say, my therapist and I are working on it. So once I get back to a place where I feel like I can wear bike shorts, maybe I'll wear some bike shorts.
All right.
I thought they were cute. I just,
Following up on her universe, you guys, we did do some WonderCon coverage. Kai and myself, and also BJ, did some WonderCon coverage. So you guys can check that out on fangirlsgoingrogue.com. But I wanted to talk about here was just briefly the Her Universe fashion show panel, which was discussing next year or this year's virtual fashion show. So everybody can go. But Sarah and I were there the last fashion show, which was 2019 now. Ugh. At San Diego Comic-Con. And finally, it was cool because Adria Renee and Sarah Hambly were the winners of that. They were the judges winner and the audience winners. And on their panel, they got to talk a lot about their designs and then designing the Wonder Woman collection afterwards. So more so for the talk about the process of them of getting to be in the fashion show and what happened afterward is the reason to check out that panel. It's still up on WonderCon. That's the great thing about these virtual WonderCon panels and San Diego Comic-Con. Anytime you can go look at them still. They're still there forever, which didn't used to be, right? Had to go to the con or you didn't. So I definitely recommend if you're sitting there, you want something to listen to and kind of feel good about being a fan and supporting people and doing stuff like that, check it out. Because especially Sarah Hambly, I was like totally impressed. Like she taught herself how to do all the sewing stuff. And now she teaches people on her social media and videos and stuff, how to do stuff. And I looked at her Instagram and stuff. I was like, holy moly, this girl is really talented. So, yeah.
Well, and I just want to say really quick, because it sounded really negative, I still love Her Universe. I'm just pointing out the things that are becoming kind of obvious.
I really
want Her Universe to reinvigorate what made them so good.
Yeah.
You know? A lot of times they'll use the same design, and just plop a different franchise on it. And sometimes that gets a little you know? Yeah.
Yeah. I love Her Universe. I still buy from Her Universe. I mean, heck, the other day, a month ago, I bought seconds of things I already have because I don't want to run out of them.
There you go. Yeah. So when she does it right, she does it really right.
Yeah. I just buy multiples of the same thing.
Hey, I do that with shoes.
Oh, yeah. That you always. And jeans. Mm-hmm. Jeans. That's a big one. All right. So our last thing in Collecting Corner, I'm going to fill you guys in on a little tea here. So Loungefly partners with a bunch of different websites. There's a website called grottotreasures.com that they were partnering with. And they released 5 exclusive Star Wars designs to grottotreasures.com.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
A Jango Fett helmet backpack, a Mandalorian helmet backpack, an Ahsoka backpack, and a Rex backpack. The 5th one was the Ahsoka Clone Trooper backpack. Oh. Now, they had limited stock. They only had a certain number. And they made the Ahsoka Clone Trooper backpack only available in a bundle of buying all 5. You had to pay $400 to get the Clone Trooper backpack, and you had to get all the 4 others, even if you didn't want them, in order to get the Clone Trooper one.
Holy crap.
That's really weird.
And the Clone Trooper one was the only one that I wanted. Some people that I know had some good ideas where they had people pitch in that were like, you know, well, I want this one. I want that one. Well, the thing is they only had 600 of those bundles and they sold out in 2 minutes because they didn't put a cap on how many you could buy.
So people bought like 10 bundles?
Yeah, I think so. I heard somewhere that it was a limit of 2, but I was following the Instagram post and I never saw that there was a limit. So there was that. Also, the all other 4 of the backpacks, other than the Clone Trooper one, had extras that they could sell individually. But the Rex one, which of course is going to be a really popular one, only had 200 to sell individually. Luckily, our friend Jonah Marie was able to get one. I don't know how she pulled it off, but she was able to get one. All the others only had like 300 or 400, except for Mandalorian and Ahsoka. There was like 900 of them. But by the time I went and checked, about an hour after everything released, they were completely sold out.
And now you can find like the bundle of 5 on eBay for $750.
What about just the Clone Trooper?
I've only seen the bundle Clone Trooper.
So anyway, I'm just saying that I understand limited edition. I understand exclusive. I get it. However, I'm sick of it. And I just don't see why we can't just make things available to people to be able to have them. Why do we have to continue in this culture of limited edition crap?
$1,250 or best offer.
And holy crap. So I'm just saying, like, as a collector, I understand it. I get it. And I have some of those pieces, but I also don't like the mentality of limited edition and exclusive. I'm not a fan.
I actually don't understand it, because why not make as many? The people who are making money are the collectors, not the.
Yeah.
I mean, Disney has a gazillion ears. You could go into any Disney anywhere and find a gazillion, whatever, Mickey rose ears. Gold. Yeah. Mickey ears. Why? If 500,000 people want Ahsoka ears at $75, why wouldn't you make 500,000?
Right.
I guess the part of me that gets it is from the collector point of view, you know, that they like making things that are limited edition, you know, a certain color, or like it's gold plated or fuzzy or whatever. I get it. But like, if it's just a one time, if it's a one thing, like the Ahsoka Clone Trooper backpack, everybody I know would buy one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, there's a couple individuals out there that are like $300 for just the Clone Trooper, but that's, yeah.
And they're normally $80.
Yeah. The Captain Rex is $400 on eBay, just the Captain Rex, or $200 to $400. Yeah. That's crazy. Wow.
Yeah. Holy so crap. Anyway, that's just, you know, my collecting frustration.
Moving on. See that.
I didn't tell y'all about this because I didn't when it was happening, because I didn't want you guys to get excited and then get disappointed. So I just absorbed all of that for all 3 of us. So there you go.
I still think part of the problem is a lot of people that do this type of, who are working on this. Some of them, I think they're actually know the system, and they're somehow they're making money on the side. They're profiting from the system, because there's no way for just the average Joe who's in a business to just deny the business that much money.
Like, well, this, not only that, they drop the information about these collections literally like 2 days before they launch. How I'm just supposed to have like a random $400 sitting around so that I can get something that I want?
Well, and also, I mean, we know that people from the Shop Disney site knew how to get in to the system and seed it to get in there. There were people who were getting through. So they have to have insider information. There has to be some process. And they're buying the stuff, and, you know, they buy the Ahsoka ears and put them up for $750 on eBay. They have to be giving somebody money to get there has to be reason why they're getting that information first.
Yeah. And I just want to give props to 2 companies who are not playing into this. Build-A-Bear they are constantly making the child available, and it's available at their stores now. And they are doing that with the Harry Potter bears as well. And ColourPop, they have constantly restocked the child palette. When it sells out, they've been restocking it, and it comes back, you know, within like a month or something like that. And they re-promote it again and say that it's back. So props to two companies that are doing their due diligence to make sure their product is out there and available.
Thank you.
Nice. Yeah. So thanks. All right. What do we all have going on? What's going on Hyperspace Theories?
New episode. We start our Mandalorian season 2 discussion. It'll be 3 parts. And the first part is about the Jedi. Then we're going to talk about Mandalore and the Mandalorians. And the third part, we'll finally get to Din Djarin and how all that weaves into it. And it literally took us almost 2 hours to talk about the Jedi. And how they will play into Mandalorian season 2. So that's coming.
Or do you mean Mandalorian season 3?
No, season 2. Oh. We're talking about the storytelling of season 2.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so there's a little bit of speculation, but more so it's like why is the Jedi so important? Why is this so important? What are all the things that matter from the Clone Wars, Star Wars Rebels? We break down specific episodes that you could go watch and discuss, and then talk about Luke Skywalker a little bit, because obviously he is the Jedi that ends up showing up, and why it had to be Luke Skywalker.
Nice. Looking forward to that. And Teresa, you have been talking about the stuff that's right behind you on your bookcase in a big way.
All right. This is actually really hard for me. You guys know I do not like to plug myself. I do not like to promote myself. That's just not something that I do. I don't love it. But I did a thing during the middle of the pandemic back in like June. There is a gentleman by the name of Guillermo Olivero. Or was it Olivero? Either way, he's awesome. And he is a big time collector, big time Star Wars collector. He's listened to Fangirls Going Rogue for a long time. So he knows about the products that I've put out. He's listened to some of my other podcasts and stuff like that. And he knew I was a collector, and he reached out. And I remember him reaching out a few times prior to this, and just nothing ever lined up for me to be able to work with him. And he did a documentary called Plastic Crack, which is talking about collecting and how collecting is an addiction, which I'll agree it is. I mean, when you start collecting, sometimes you just can't stop. So there was a documentary series, and in that documentary series, they actually would go to people's houses and film their collections and talk about it and all in person. Well, as he was getting ready to do season 2 of Plastic Crack, the pandemic hit. And so it got turned into a thing called Plastic Chats. So instead of going to people's houses and being able to film their collections, everything was done virtually. And so I was in my room where all my Star Wars stuff is, and I got a chance to just sit and talk about collecting and talk about collections that I have and all kinds of stuff. There's some things I talk about in there that a lot of people don't even know that I have as, you know, collecting pieces. And I was told, as they were working through the editing and things like that, I don't know what happened, but our like Zoom connection or Skype connection or whatever it was, it created like this weird, I know, distortion in the file, and they couldn't get rid of it. So there's a little bit of an audio issue on my episode, but just, you know, just get used to it, because it's fine. It's fine. Because I asked about it and we tried to fix it and we couldn't fix it. But there, I think there was like 8 or 10 people that they interviewed, and the team over at the studio that produced this liked my episode so much, they put it in the first 4 that they released. So it is actually episode 4. And you can listen to it now for free on Spotify. And then it was being approved for all the other podcast places, which can take a while sometimes. So it should be out on Apple Podcasts soon. And then if you use a podcatcher like Overcast or something like that, it should be available there. And that's going to be just the audio of it. It is available on video. If you go over to Vimeo, you can rent the episodes, and it's $2 because it's Vimeo on demand. And you can rent the actual video of the episode. I would recommend watching the video because there's a lot of pictures in there.
There's a lot of pictures of us. Fangirls.
Yes, there is. There's a lot of pictures of fangirls. They had a very long list of things that they wanted me to put pictures in for. I gave them a Dropbox link that had somewhere between 100 and 200 pictures, and they wanted specifically pictures of me and Sarah, pictures of me and Tricia, pictures of us all together, pictures of this, pictures of that. There's literally pictures from the first time I've ever like met you guys in this thing. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of
works.
Yeah. So there's a lot of stuff in there. Eventually the hope is that Plastic Chats will be on Amazon. Apparently there was a deal with Amazon for it to be available there as a series, and then Amazon changed their agreements and things like that. So we're working on it, but it's a very diverse group of people that they interviewed for collecting. There's a lot of women. There's a lot of people of color. It's hosted by a person of color, which is amazing. Guillermo's just a super nice person. And I'm honored that he thought of me to do this. And so anyway, yeah, you can check out Plastic Chats. And if you need links, we'll put them in our show notes. Or you can just DM me on Instagram, and I will give you the links for it.
They'll be in the show notes.
Yeah. Nice. Well, that brings me to my plug. After 411 days, you guys, Disneyland is reopening on April 30th. And I'm going to be there. I'm going to be there.
Are you excited?
I'm so excited. Oh my gosh. Okay. So you have to get like reservations now, and you have to buy tickets now. There's no annual pass thing. So I'm buying a full price ticket, and I was able to get reserve Disneyland as my day on April 30th. And so Richard and I will be there along with several members of the Skywalking Network. We're all going to be wearing new Skywalking Network hats. It's going to be amazing. And we're going to be at the parks. And Richard and I, in the lead up to this, we did this series of getting back in Disneyland shape videos on the Skywalking Through Neverland YouTube channel. And they're really cute. And I hope it gets everyone ready or just excited to see us get ready for Disneyland. But there's some good useful information on there as well, such as taking walks and eating kind of healthy leading up to your Disney day and all things like that. So we are excited, and we're going to be at the parks, and we're going to be live streaming and taking video and just sharing it with all of you guys. And also, Avengers Campus is opening June 4th at DCA. We have reservations for that day as well at DCA. We're going to be there for opening. I'm so excited because the capacity is only 25 to 35%. And so
yep.
I'm hoping this is going to be like really awesome and not completely crowded like a normal opening like this would be. So we're going to be there really early on April 30th and on Avengers Campus opening just to see how it is, just to soak in the atmosphere. Cause part of the fun of it is the anticipation and like the waiting in line, even if you are 6 feet apart from people. So yeah, we're going to be there. We're going to be sharing, and I'm so excited. So make sure to head over to the Skywalking Through Neverland YouTube channel, because we are like 8 away from 5,000 subscribers, which is exciting. So yay.
Oh, and something else I want to plug for Skywalking Through Neverland, because I don't think Sarah really knows how to plug this for herself, but Skywalking Through Neverland's Twitch channel got enough followers to become an affiliate with Twitch, and you can actually now subscribe to their Twitch channel and give them bits so that they make some money off of the streams that they do on Twitch. So please go over there and subscribe. I was their first sub.
You were.
That's what we call it on Twitch. I was their first sub. you guys need to upload some emotes so that I have perks for being a sub.
Okay.
We'll talk about that later. I'm helping Sarah learn Twitch right now. But yes, go sub to them on Twitch.
Nice. That's twitch.tv/skywalkingpod. I know how to plug that.
I do have two questions for you, though.
Oh, okay.
So currently for Disneyland, you have to be a California resident to go, correct?
Correct.
All right. And is there park hopping?
Yes. Yeah. You can park hop at 1 p.m. And the parks are open from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. right now.
But can you only park hop if there's availability in the park that they're not at capacity?
Correct. Yes. And also, like, let's say you want to park hop on April 30th from DCA to Disneyland, and you have a dining reservation at Disneyland or a Rise of the Resistance reservation, well, those will not guarantee you entry into Disneyland. The capacity has to be available.
Damn.
I know. And I was scared because I originally had a reservation for DCA on April 30th. And then like availability opened up again last week. And my friend was like on it. She was like, do this. You got to go. You got to go switch it now. And I was able to switch. So.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, you guys. All right. Well, normally we would have had our character discussion, but as we stated before, it will be coming out on May 4th.
You're getting a little bonus mini episode on May the 4th to talk about the clones.
Something that comes out on May the 4th.
Oh, it's not a secret. We're not going to talk about the clones. We're going to talk about the Bad Batch, but we can't talk about it today. So we're going to talk about it. Oh, wait. Well, we're going to talk about it today, but we're not going to share it with you today. Sneaky, right. Sneaky little bits that we are. So let's close the show up then.
All right, you guys, you can visit us in between shows over at fangirlsgoingrogue.com. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at FGGoingRogue. Trisha is at Fangirl Cantina. I am at Ice Cold Penguin. Sarah is at Jedi Tink. Sandra is at Geek Chic 9. And Kai is at Yogi Kai.
You can leave us a voicemail 331-21 Ewoks or 331-213-9657. Email contact at fangirlsgoingrogue.com.
And you can join us on Facebook. Either follow our page, Fangirls Going Rogue, or join our Facebook group. So just search Facebook for Fangirls Going Rogue group and then request to join. Yes, I was about to say skywalking because I say that every week. And then answer the questions that pop up or we can't let you in.
And please go to Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to podcasts and leave a positive 5-star review. We need your review so more people can find us. Until next time.
Dude.
I did it! I said her line! I'm rolling. Okay. You're going to have to edit.
I'm upset now. So until next time. Do, 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 do. Yub.
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 And it's time for margarita cupcakes.
And happy May the 4th.
This episode is brought to you by Small World Vacations. They are a diamond level vacation planner. Something, something, something. I have so much stuff from y'all's stuff memorized because it's what you say on your wraparounds that I watch.
So funny.
Noopa, noopa.